So thank you very much for the introduction. Welcome to the Smart and Sustainable Cities panel of the KONE Experience, where we're joined by three magnetic and inspiring guests. Professor Koon Hean Cheong is a career senior public servant in Singapore, where she has led the great city-shaping agencies of the nation for the past 30 years. Thomas Heatherwick is the acclaimed and outstanding designer who masters the art and craft of places that inspire, enrich, and include human experience. Matt Gough leads the innovation practice at Mace, a global expert in shaping the built environment to lead to a more connected, resilient, and sustainable world. A big welcome to our three very distinguished panelists. We're going to discuss three big topics. Firstly, what is the process of change that's happening in cities? Secondly, can we afford the transition? And thirdly, what makes it work? So let's get started, if we may. I want to ask the question, what is really driving the process of change in our cities? And Koon Hean, will you start, please?
Thank you, Greg, and hello, everybody. Well, cities are subject to many drivers of change. I think first is about people movement. There is really rapid urbanization of cities, and this put a lot of pressures on cities having to deal with this surge of people into cities, giving amenities, affordable housing, everything that people need for a decent quality of life. But I think the second driver really is environmental. And as we can see, the pandemic has spotlighted the focus on health and wellness in cities. And of course, the climate emergency that we are facing means that cities really now need to be climate ready, sustainable, and more resilient. So we hear a lot of buzzwords, decarbonization and net zero, things we have to deal with. The third driver is technological. Cities are becoming increasingly reliant on technology as digital technology, and this is exacerbated by the pandemic. And finally, I think the fourth driver is a social one, very important one. There is concern with rising inequality in cities, and this is caused by many reasons: market gaps, skill gaps, the digital divide, and again, exacerbated by the pandemic.
Thomas, please pick this up and give us your perspective. What do you see as being the process of change and the drivers of change in cities?
As Koon Hean says, there's a lot of buzzwords. There's lots of talk about being climate aware and sustainable. But there's a huge gap in all of our understandings about the place, the mental health of ourselves, and the catastrophe that's been unfolding around ourselves over the last century of places that were not designed for our emotions. And my hope is that the digital revolution, this technological side that's really transforming cities by making irrelevant the assumptions that city centres were based on, which was based on shopping. Now that shopping really can't be the driver of the hearts of places, because that's something that is no longer an imperative that has to be on the street level and pushing out social life. I mean, what a weird construct that our city centres sort of lost public life, because I think governments lost their confidence to make pieces of cities, and the buildings themselves became so sterile and personalityless. And whether you're in Asia, the Arctic Circle, Europe, buildings all look the same. And it's not for just being crazy. We need, there's a visual complexity necessary to make something human, to engage your interest. So I think emotion is the big thing that I think we need to get our confidence back again.
Thomas, thank you very much indeed. There's a very clear and I think very exciting proposition here about the emotional intelligence of place. Matt, let's bring in you. Let's have your perspective on this big question. What is the process of change and what are the drivers of change in cities as you see it?
I think the point that Thomas makes about rethinking capitalism and having a much more kind of social conscience in cities and places is an important one. But I think for me, that what's changing or what's driving change is probably comes back to where we just started this panel and Professor Koon Hean here around, I guess, just this demand for more, for growth almost. And just to quantify that, by 2050, there'll be nearly 10 billion people on this planet. That's beyond rapid population growth. It took us 120 odd years to move from 1 billion to 2 billion people on planet Earth, and we're about to add 3 billion in the next 30. So the future is more cities, okay? As we just sort of talked about, that 70% of those people are going to want to move to the cities. In order to accommodate that change, we need to build a lot of new buildings and infrastructure to design, to construct, to upgrade and maintain. And we need to do so responsibly.
Matt, thank you very much. So let's go immediately to our second question, which is about how and whether and in what ways we can afford the transition that cities need to make.
I think we can afford the transition that cities need to make, Greg. And I think I'd perhaps be a bit more challenging and say, can we afford not to make the transition that cities need to make, if I'm honest? And the answer to that is no. Historically, if I was a climate evangelist, then, you know, very regularly I would be laughed out of rooms because, you know, the commercial lead would come into play and say, oh, that's all a wonderful idea, but it's going to cost more money, so we'll get rid of that, right? And I think that paradigm has changed because, you know, the developers, the funders, the investors are now recognizing the cost of the kind of climate impact. It's now cheaper to you know, leverage debt or get credit if you have good green credentials. And lo and behold, you know, if you are involved in the developing and construction of cities, people are drawn towards better performing kind of buildings and infrastructure in relation to the climate. So not only is it sort of cheaper to fund, but it's also you're going to drive up a premium from a price perspective. So we're watching the kind of alignment at, you know, the big fiscal level. And now what I guess we're sort of starting to watch and really trying to lean into is how do we make that happen on a sort of day-to-day level, on a tactical level. And the reality is that at this point in time, there is a green premium. You know, I hate to say it, but, you know, the cost of using advanced materials or in some respects, you know, the use of hydrogen fuel on our construction sites rather than traditional diesel, you know, there's still a price to pay, a premium to pay for that. And that's where we're watching, I guess, globally, governments lean in with, you know, investment into the sort of technologies and new ways of, you know, fuels, materials, whatever it might be, energy, renewables, in order to help drive that change.
Great, Matt, thank you very much. Very clear points that in a sense that there is a green premium, but on the other hand, it's inevitable that all of our markets and our governments are moving in this direction. So why not be an innovator? Koon Hean, it strikes me that Singapore is a place that decided a long time ago that the transition to good urbanization has to be affordable. Is that right?
Well, I agree with Matt that we cannot afford not to change, especially towards being climate ready and greater resilience. But can we afford it? Well, there is tension and there is a cost. So the big challenge for us is how do we get there? How do you deal with the transition to get there? And well, in our own experience, it is important to take a very long-term view to understand the roadmap to getting there. And it's not overnight, it takes years. So having a long-term view is important and the roadmap to getting there is important because then you understand all the trade-offs that are needed. And because we all have limited resources, it helps us to prioritize those resources in this journey to getting there. Now, government plays a very important role. I've been in public service, and I know that it can move the needle because the government is a big buyer and procurer. So let me just give an example. We're going to introduce a carbon tax. It's going to be quite painful, but we give people plenty of notice to transit, and the price of carbon will go up progressively until a much higher number in 2030, about $50 to $80 a ton from its very low today, $5. You know, that's not going to shift the needle for companies. So we have to make that transition, but you have to work with industry, public-private partnership, to do that transition, give people plenty of warning. So whilst the carbon tax will be imposed, there's also help for companies to do that transition.
Thank you very much. So what's your view, Thomas? Can we afford this transition? Do we know how to make it affordable?
Well, it's interesting how the human mind is in times of crisis. And the problem with humans is that we are quite clumsy and simplistic, and we dumb things into simple, understandable packages, such as talking about, Matt, you spoke about it is possible to talk about the green credentials of a building, and then have a kind of the, but I think maybe everyone here has seen examples where there's someone giving a lecture and they're telling you about, here's this building I've designed, which uses a tenth the amount of energy, that, you know, uses half the water, da da da. But you look at it and you just think, that is a horrible place you've just made that contributes nothing to the city. And so I'm interested in the yes, green credentials, but the human credentials. And in times of crisis, we all know you revert to survival mode. And there's a green credentials survival mode, but there's a true, true green credential, which is has to include the human premium. So we've got a green premium, but there's a human premium to making something. Let's talk about it as the modest cathedral thinking, because obviously we can't all just build cathedrals that kill hundreds of workers as we go, but why is it that we can look at the most humblest housing from 200 years ago and it's got love and care and it's got humanness in it and wasn't a cathedral, but we're cherishing those buildings in the same way we will cherish cathedrals? And we haven't found a language to talk about this. And it's actually this paradox that we need to be doing thousand-year thinking when we're in a crisis. That is the time that you do this.
Matt, what's your favourite catalyst for this kind of long-term, high-investment, high-return thinking? Is it about public space? Is it great architecture? Is it improved connectivity indeed? Is it a new energy system? Is it the humble homes that Thomas was talking about a couple of minutes ago?
I feel like the places that work are those that really are clear and focus on the experience in some respects, you know, and we're witnessing, there's been a continual influx in rapid acceleration of technology. But the interesting thing, and, you know, there's a lot of alignment here in the UK, and we're seeing it in sort of other geographies as well, around maybe a pushback against technology, you know, open data for the public good, as we refer to it here. You know, we are going to capture more data. We are going to be able to use that to improve the performance of spaces. But how do we do so responsibly and giving, you know, power and that ownership and stewardship of data back to society rather than just sort of monetizing it and capitalizing on it? So technology, I do see as a big driver, but really focused on improving the experiences of places. And that comes back to Thomas's point, which is, you know, really around those sort of basic human needs.
Thank you, Matt. It's a very helpful reminder that technology can be a servant of placemaking and of human experience. It doesn't have to be something that simply automates and robotizes things. So Let's go to our third question, which is about what is really needed to secure outcomes in place.
I think that carrying on like we are is just going to, we're going to swing across to another sort of fad of thinking, which will result again in places that are inhuman, but in a different way. So there's a success possibly in green credentials, but a failure in human real placemaking. We need actually a global movement that is a humanizing of place movement. And that it needs to be a very major shift across policy, but in the public. This can't just be amongst architects and designers. This must be about how we really recognize that we have been dehumanizing cities systematically in the emotional experience. And we are understanding, we're still in early days of actually talking about society's mental health, but we've still got a long way to join the dots that the places around us have not been supporting that mental health. And in anywhere you go, if you ask someone, where would you like to go? Would you like to go to the new bit or the old bit? Everyone will go, oh, show me the old bit. Because you know the new bit all will all look the same or feel the same. And we need a global movement, and we need to find a way to phrase that to every 13-year-old and all of ourselves, because they will drive it to happen. And if it's just within specialized group like us, we'll all nod and agree and go, yeah, absolutely, great, and leave with a kind of little mini buzz, and it'll push us in a way. But unless there is the real demand from society to no longer accept the inhuman placemaking, it's going to carry on, and it'll be a kind of greeny version, but it won't, we will look back in another 30, 40, 50, 100 years, and we'll be demolishing those buildings in the same way we've demolished the buildings that somehow people had talked themselves into thinking were good 40 years ago.
Thomas, thank you very much. So nothing less than a generational change and a global movement is required. Matt, what's your view? What's necessary to really secure these kind of place outcomes that we've been talking about?
I would say, again, glass half full, I do feel that there is definitely sort of trending and direction of travel towards a more outcome-based decision-making around the built environment. And I'll call again on a UK example. So here in the UK, we're working through a sector transformation for the construction sector. And one of the sort of big policy changes that have been enacted is around something referred to as the construction playbook. How should the public sector procure construction? And one of the tools within that is something referred to as the value toolkit. And that is something that, based on, you know, the five capital values and applying the thinking of, you know, your donut economics type model, how do we procure things not just on lowest cost, but on the other sort of more societal outcomes that we might be able to generate as a result of development and city planning, etc. So, you know, with these projects that we are intending to do, can we create jobs? Can we train people in new skills? Can we decarbonize? Can we improve people's mental and physical health as a result of what we're doing?
Matt, thank you very much. There's a lot in what you say about what's sometimes called the co-benefits or the multipliers or the positive external returns. Funny language, isn't it? But it's all about how you make places that achieve the human outcomes that Thomas was beginning to talk about a few minutes ago. Koon Hean, what's your view about this? What's really needed to secure these kind of high quality place outcomes with which Singapore, of course, is so associated, but you've looked at places all over the world. What makes the difference?
Well, I think there are a couple of things to remember to try and achieve these outcomes. I still think long-term planning and city planning is important, because there are big pieces that require a very long-term view. And these are macro issues that you have to think about, and it's perform at a city level, right? Whether you plan for airports and, you know, the huge infrastructure, that needs a little bit of top-down thinking and long-term thinking. So first, it's that process of looking long-term, but at the same time, building into the plans the concerns of human touch, the human centricity, the livability, the identity, building social cohesion, building memories. I think these are important in any planner or architects who are working on some of these plans. So I think this is an exercise where you have the public and private engagement, the interest groups, all brought together to find a common way forward that works. And I think that process is very important.
And it sounds like you're saying that the richness of the dialogue and the interaction somehow determines the degree to which the human interest really in the end comes through, which sounds very interesting. Thank you very much indeed. But my one regret about this conversation is that we don't have time for more. I want to give a big thank you to Thomas Heatherwick, to Matt Gough, and to Professor Koon Hean Cheong. And I'm now going to hand back to the studio and the KONE Experience. Thank you all very much indeed.